So welcome to anybody who is interested in potentially attending Concordia for nursing. And I would like to just inform you about what our faculty does in the classroom to educate our students. Of course, we all, when we start our lectures, have objectives that we would like to see our students meet during the class period. So for my presentation today, at least, the few objectives I came up with is for you to understand the various learning techniques we use in the classroom and how we realize and understand that everyone has different learning styles. And we really try to focus and gear our teaching methods towards the different learning styles that our students in our classroom have. I would like you to understand what takes place in our nursing classes that our various professors teach, and identify that attending Concordia University, I think, really would be a great choice for you to make, and I think hopefully you'd find it to be a very good fit for you. So before I even continue, again, I think one of the most wonderful aspects about Concordia, and now we have just gotten affirmation about this, so it's not just me making this comment or making this statement. Our seniors take a survey upon completion of their program, typically in their final semester. And we had just received results of those surveys that were sent out to the students. And it was so awesome to read the comments that students had made, because they really shared that they felt the nursing faculty is what made them the most successful academically, and they really felt that we had made their time at Concordia to be a wonderful time. Again, we're a Christian-based university. They really felt that the faculty portrayed that and were great at listening to them, praying with them if needed, giving them Christian guidance, feedback from a Christian aspect, and they truly did appreciate that. So again, I don't mind saying that, and don't feel as if I'm tooting my own horn, since we actually heard that as feedback from our students. Again, most of our nursing classes are approximately an hour and 20 minutes long, and we meet twice a week, usually Mondays and Fridays, in the classroom. And while we're in the classroom, again, the faculty really do try to make the experience as engaging and interactive as possible. So most of the nursing classes, typically at the start of class, we like to engage the students, ask if anybody has any announcements. Typically, us as professors do have some announcements for the students, and it's great. While it's fine, we could send emails out to everybody, it is so much nicer to just talk face to face and see people and make announcements and get feedback from students then. We also, most of us like to start our classes with a devotion, which actually I have one here today that I was going to share with you, because specifically I teach pediatric nursing. And in my classroom, what I like to do also is incorporate what we're talking about for that class period, incorporate that into the devotion that I present. So for example, if I was doing my cardiac lecture, I have a devotion that is called the heart transplant. And a Bible verse I'm gonna quote is from Ezekiel 11:19. And it says, I will give them singleness of heart and put a new spirit within them. I will take away their hearts of stone and give them tender hearts instead. So have you ever heard of a person needing a heart transplant and someone still alive saying, take mine? It happened. At the cross, God the Father accepted the heart of his only son, Jesus Christ, and offered it to a dying world. The Bible says that we each need a new heart because our human heart is stubborn and rebellious, deceitful and wicked, and able to turn us away from God. But God promises a new heart. God made a promise about this divine transplant. To the believers in Corinth, Paul wrote that they were a letter from Christ, written not with pen and ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. It is carved not on stone, but on human hearts, 2 Corinthians 3:3. If you desire this heart transplant, God promises to give you his heart as your own. Only then can you begin to develop God-honoring character. As we come to him for forgiveness, he has promised to help us live in moral excellence. Such character is impossible apart from the Holy Spirit's work in our new heart. By accepting this new heart, we can share in his divine nature. The heart transplant is only the beginning, but you do need to begin. Do you want godly character? Let God give you a new heart. And so I even open it up to my students and the first day of class, share with them that I try to gear our devotions towards what we are talking about for that lecture, and invite them, if anybody finds any creative devotions to share with the class, they are more than welcome to, because sometimes it does get a little tricky when we get into gastrointestinal function or different specialties areas. But then also, and I believe all of our faculty do this as well, we like to pray with our students. So we also ask for any prayer requests and open it up at that time. And then we proceed with the rest of the class. I did put on here lecture, but as you will see while we go through this, my presentation, that doesn't necessarily just mean the professor talking to you and preaching to you or lecturing. And one thing I'd also like to iterate, all of us truly do enjoy interaction in the classroom as far as even questions. So again, I would say even during this time, if there have been any questions, people would be more than welcome to raise their hand, let me know, and chime in again, because I don't, and I speak for all the faculty, don't think anybody ever just wants to be the one talking to our audience. I'm not sure if everybody is aware of the different types of learning styles that everybody, each of us possess and have. So visual is pretty much that, you know, looking at PowerPoints such as this. And I know people like sometimes feel they are PowerPointed to death because now it's been around so long. But, you know, that can also include some videos. Auditory, so listening again to a lecture, someone talking to you, but that could also be group discussion. And then kinesthetic learning, which is more the hands-on, and we'll go through these more specifically, and I'll give you examples of what we do in our classrooms for each of these. But then also lastly, reading and writing, which I think is probably least favorite of all students, especially in nursing. Primarily because you will find, and I don't want to turn anybody off from nursing, but fortunately we do not have the smallest textbooks out there. And whether we like it or not, even as professors, we know no one wants to do the readings, but there is value to it and lots of reading that can be done to obtain knowledge about nursing. So what a lot of us do for our visual learners, again, I think most of us still use a PowerPoint as that go-to backup, but I don't think we simply or surely rely on our PowerPoints and like to utilize other interactive activities and other ways of learning into just our PowerPoint. And just to back up, again, on the previous slide on the bottom, you will find a link. If you have never taken or completed a questionnaire survey regarding what type of learner you are, go to that link, just a few questions. I think you would find it very beneficial prior to starting college or at a university so that you personally know what or how you learn best. And again, as professors, we like to go around the room, or I do on the first day, and ask my students how they feel that they learn best. Because again, my goal and hope and prayer is that I try to gear my teaching style to my audience and how my students learn best. Again, that can be very challenging. This last semester, I had 36 students in my classroom. So again, then I just try to use variety and grab something or incorporate something into my lecture from all the different learning styles. So hopefully I can meet the needs of all my students. So with, again, our visual learners, other things are pictures. I love including pictures, especially being, again, the pediatric teacher, and I have three children of my own. A lot of the pictures that I use also are for my family, for my children. So my students get to know them. They get to see lots of pictures of them growing up. But I think for the visual learners, pictures just speak volumes. And another way I incorporate this is even when we're talking about different systems, different illnesses, sometimes I use that as a tool and have students find pictures that they can share with their peers when they are describing different illnesses or different body systems. So I think that really helps the visual learners. And then as we go through this, the activities where I have them find pictures and then they're sharing it with others, also that's incorporating different learning styles. And then lastly, for visual learners, graphs, tables are great, like I have on here. I think that's really good, especially for statistics or when we're talking about different diseases, illnesses. Again, pictures speak volumes, especially to our visual learners. This is an exact slide from my growth and development lecture that I have. And it really, I show this to my students, and all five of these are the most influential factors on growth and development for our children. So one, hereditary, which is a picture in the top. And to me, you know, that speaks hereditary. It's a huge family right there. Growth and development can be influenced by just genetic. Are you male? Are you female? Nature, the top right picture, has a lot to play on our growth and development. Obviously nutrition, and I tell my students, actually nutrition is the number one influential factor on cognitive as well as physical growth and development. And then lastly, illnesses or germs, and I think we're all going to see that how germs and like COVID is impacting and influencing the growth and development of our children. So another learning style that is out there is auditory learning, and we like to incorporate different pieces of this into our lectures as well. Again, oral presentations, and that is not just me talking to the students or again preaching to the students. That one thing that I do, and I believe a lot of our faculty utilize, is having the students do different presentations on different topics. As well as when I have my students do presentations, I have them work as a group, which is another good tool for our students to learn, because we all know, especially in healthcare, no one can be successful on their own. So in the clinical setting, as well as when they get out in their profession, they really have to learn how to and know how to collaborate and work well in groups, because that makes the outcomes for our patients that much better. And their care is improved drastically if we're all collaborating and working together as a group. So again, that's kind of one thing that I'll do in the classroom that's tying in two of these pieces, because the groups obviously have to break out, do discussions together while they're formulating their presentation that they're going to present to the rest of their classmates. Again, videos are great. I like to utilize them a lot in my classroom. Again, not as the sole teaching, but reiterating what I'm also teaching, maybe in a visual form to my students. And I, hopefully you'll be able to see this, have a little video here to just portray one, some of the videos that we may show in a classroom.
Last question. is that going to be on the exam? So my friend's cousin, his mom has the exact same thing that you're talking about. I don't know when she got it, but I can find out. That's all definitely up to you. Since we're talking about blisters, I actually got a blister on my foot. It must be from these new shoes, but you guys can come around and I'll show you. Oh, I'm freaking out. If I can't pass this exam, how am I going to pass this class, and how am I going to pass the program? I don't know how well I'm going to do. I might as well just drop out of this program. Did you hear those symptoms she said? I have the exact same thing. Maybe I have diabetes. Maybe I have cancer. Maybe I have heart failure. But I'm so young. Sorry I'm late. The Starbucks line was like crazy long again. Sorry I'm late, the traffic was crazy today. Sorry I'm late, I don't want to come to school today. That would be the vagus nerve. It's obviously the P wave. Red blood cells.
Okay. Okay. So again, that video even portrays the different types of personalities we see in our nursing students. And honestly, as faculty and as faculty advisors, we do try to work with all of our students, and we engage all different types of personalities. And again, try to gear our teaching methods to fit different teaching styles, as well as the different personalities of our students. Which again are the more hands-on learners. And I think as a professor, most of the students that we have in our classroom today, and not to say that this is the best way of learning, I think a lot of students really do identify themselves as a kinesthetic learner. And that kind of ties in with the nursing profession in general. Because obviously in the hospital, a lot of what we do is hands-on care, as well as that emotional support, but a lot of the tasks then even that we do, starting IVs, putting different tubes like in a nose or different things, doing wound care, it's all hands-on. So again, I think that kinesthetic learning kind of ties in or just goes real well with nursing in general. Some of the things we'll use in the classroom then to support that kinesthetic learning is role playing, which I know personally I use for one of my lectures, if you will, or in the classroom, where I give 2 to 3 students, they work together again as a group, so addressing another learning style. And I give them a diagnosis, and one of them will be the nurse, one of them will be the patient, and one of them will be the child, because I'm in pediatric nursing. And they will role play a situation of the diagnosis for the rest of their class and see if their class can identify what diagnoses that they are role playing. Note taking is included in kinesthetic learning. However, again, it's probably not a favorite learning technique of our students. And if students do struggle, however, with note taking, the nice thing at Concordia, we have different resources for them to utilize to become a better note taker, and that is our Learning Resource Center, and they will help students with that. Lastly, other hands-on activities we do in class, maybe different games, if you will, and I have some examples of those as well in the upcoming slides. And in my class, what I like to do, again, because it's pediatric nursing, and I try to get my students to think like a child, that I also bring Play-Doh and crayons and coloring sheets so that my students, if they aren't at a point that they feel they need to write down the notes, they can play with the Play-Doh, or if they're taking a quiz or test, sometimes that just helps them with their learning and helps to calm them if they have Play-Doh or some type of stress balls that they can use. So, again, one example that's hands-on is we'll play a Jeopardy game in class. And again, it's incorporating a couple different learning styles because I have the students work as a group and form a team to answer the Jeopardy questions. And of course, we try to make it fun, so we also have prizes for them when we play this.
First round, the Jeopardy round.
And I still think it's very effective for their learning on this topic of hematology, oncology, or cancer, because again, as you can see, all the questions that are going to be asked are very nursing related. It's the teaching we're doing, it's how we're diagnosing their the different diagnoses, tests and procedures that we'll do, nursing management and the care they have to provide to their patient, and then complications that we may see in our patients that have the different diagnoses. And then if you aren't familiar, jumping ahead here. Kahoot, and you can go to this. I did have some questions that we could answer, but if you go to Kahoot.com, you would log in and I as an instructor would have questions for you. And what that is it's either a polling system and or I'll use multiple choice questions. And the students would use either their computer or their phone, and they are able to anonymously answer the questions. And then as a group, we can see the results. Again, students really love this. They're using their hands when they're answering the questions on their device. And again, it's that competition love. Lots of students love the competition, so they get very engaged when we're playing Kahoot. And then lastly, like I had mentioned, a learning style is reading and writing, probably one of the least favorite things that students like to do, again, especially because nursing, we have such big textbooks, but unfortunately that's part of it. And I always share with students, if reading is the way you learn best, make sure you're doing all the readings. If not, again, let me know. We can find other activities to engage you and enhance your learning so you still understand the content. And again, I discuss taking notes, again, that incorporates both this type of learning style and another learning style. But another thing, again, in my class, because it is pediatric nursing, I like to just share jokes with my students that they can then take into the hospital setting at Children's and use with their patients. So why did the pirate go on vacation? Because he needed a little R&R. And if anybody has any questions at any point, Study Abroad has my email. I am more than happy to answer any questions for you and really wish you well and best of luck in your college career.